This week on Dig Me Out. With your hosts, Jason Diaz and Tim Minichi.
Jay, this week we're back with an album review, but it's not just any album review, Jay.
Oh yeah, what's so special about it?
It's our Halloween episode. Insert
spooky
Halloween sounds. Yeah, we're gonna make this a tradition. I decided upon that. Last year we did the Groovy Ghoulies, thanks to Eric Peterson's pick. It was a perfect holiday pick for the All Hallows Eve. And I said, hey, this one lands on the 30th, the day before Halloween. Let's do another one. So we made it our third quarter contest. Whoever was a Patreon subscriber by the end of the third quarter of 2018 got their name entered. And I used a internet randomizer website to, after assigning a number to each name, and the number came back, and the winner joining us from, I forget, is it Chicago? Is that right?
Right outside of Chicago, Brookfield.
Welcome, OC.
Hey, how's it going? Thanks for having me, guys. I'm glad I have this opportunity for you.
Tell everyone for this evilest of episodes what you have chosen to...
Well, when I was thinking about the spirit of Halloween, I think of haunted houses, I think of costumes and scary movies that usually include a bit of gore and all that type of stuff. And mm-hmm. I kind of thought that the most perfect Halloween band I could come up with was Gwar. And I hear their opus is Scumdogs of the Universe from 1990.
Excellent. Jay, were you familiar
yes.
with Gwar? You probably knew the name, but had you ever yeah. listened to them or seen them live?
Never seen them live. I remember, I remember them quite a bit. They were on Headbangers Ball, which I was a big fan of in the early 90s, in the late 80s. And I remember they would pop up in the news here and there, I remember, in kind of that time period as well. Or make appearances on different things on MTV. And I kind of heard some of the music and was well aware of the image and what the deal was.
I had neither listened to them or seen them live, but like you, I had seen them as a part of sort of culture.
Yep.
They got either arrested or were warned about like their displays of violence and sex and that kind of stuff, sexual innuendo in the 90s. I want to say probably traveling through certain southern states that happened. I'm not mm-hmm. sure where, but I think that popped up on, the MTV news more than once. And I also remember, I don't know if you remember this, Jay, but when we worked at the radio station at Bowling Green's Falcon Radio, they would often have ticket giveaways mm-hmm. that we would announce on air. And it was usually for Columbus at the Newport, or it was at Toledo at the Asylum. And I'm pretty sure Gwar was the giveaway more than once.
Yeah.
Win Gwar tickets. And we had bumpers with like Gwar music. We're like, win tickets for Gwar by listening to blah, 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 and being the no whatever caller and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So that's my exposure to Gwar. So now, see, have you seen them live?
So, I've seen them live a couple times, but not back in what I would assume is their heyday. I saw them live probably circa 2008-ish, and then another once or once and a half since at different festival appearances. So, with Gwar on the bill, in between bands, I can definitely manage to swing 20, 25 minutes to catch them in between acts. But I've definitely seen them. I've gone out and paid to see a Gwar show before. It's a sight to be seen.
I would imagine so. So a little history on the band for everybody who's not familiar. They are from Richmond, Virginia. They are still active. Started in 1984, and they've had a lot of members. The main, I guess what happened was there was actually a couple different bands. There were two different bands that were formed, that came together to form Gwar, which seems very appropriate. One was called Death Piggy, and it was fronted by Dave Brocky, who I believe passed away a couple years ago.
Yeah, 2015 or 16, I think.
Heroin overdose in 2014.
Yeah.
Yes.
14, okay.
But they have actually gone on and other people, so they was playing a particular character, and other people have stepped in to play characters, to not necessarily his character, but filled the role his character.
Yeah, I think they retired the character. I think his name was Odorous Arungus.
Yes.
I definitely don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but yes, I've seen them since, and that same character was not on the stage.
So currently there are no original members in the band. This is like an 80s metal band. This is like when like Rat tours and like, you know, there's nobody from, it's only Bobby Blotzer. So the original lineup was, as mentioned, it was Dave Brocky and then Ben Eubanks, who played the character of Johnny Slutman. I love the names. Ross Bohorski, yeah, which was Mr. That. Magico, which is not all that scary. Chris Bothpest on bass. He played Ballsack. And Sean Sumner, who had no nickname. He was the drummer. So the drummer got... but he was replaced a year later by Jim Thompson, who played Hans Sfichter / Hans Orifice. And then he was the drummer for a number of years. We're not going to go through all the names, and just go to the Wikipedia page and you'll get the list. It's pretty extensive. It's pretty amazing.
Most of those characters don't actually even make it all the way to 1990. Do that.
No,
I
no.
Think the only one that I saw, Ballsack, is still on there, but everybody else was replaced.
Right. So this is their second record. Came out in 1990. First record was Hell O. Came out in 1988. Scumdogs of the Universe came out in 1990 on Metal Blade Records, of course. It is to date the band's best-selling record, and it's a concept album explaining how Gwar, the Scumdogs, their reign of terror over the planet Earth. And on this record is Odorous Arungus, Dewey Rowell, who played Flatus Maximus, Mike Dirks, who is Ballsack, the Jaws of Death, Michael Bishop on bass, Beefcake the Mighty, Brad Roberts on drums, who played Jizmac Degusha, Danielle Stamp on backing vocals, she was Slimenstra Hyman, and Chuck also contributed vocals, Chuck Varga, who was the Sexecutioner, Don Draculich, Sleazy P. Martini, he did the vocals on Slaughterama. So that's everybody that was involved in this record. So interesting to note, there's two songs that were not included in all the versions. So track 5, The Years Without Light, and track 13, Cool Place to Park, they're only on certain versions of the release. Apparently this has gotten a number of different releases. Now, if you go into like Spotify, I believe, or whatever streaming service you use that has this, it should have all 13. So you might be holding a CD in your hand and being like, there's only 11 songs on this record. Like, nope, actually there was supposed to be 13. I'm not sure of why that didn't, you know, stay consistent across all releases, but that's what the Wikipedia says. So
the one I listened to had all 13.
Okay. So they have been consistently releasing records. They have albums out basically from 88 to 2017, every 2 to 3 years. And in the 90s, they were even more consistent. It was like every other year or every year. So, and that was, like you said, that was kind of their heyday. So let's get into talking about this record. Scumdogs of the Universe, 1990, from Gwar. This was your first time listening to this, right, OC? So tell us one thing you liked about this record.
Well, I have to say, I might be at a little bit of a disadvantage than some of your guests, because I think there's a lot of people who come on and pitch something that's really, really close to them, or you have some experts out on a round table. But I'm familiar with Gwar. This is actually the first time I've dove into a record of Gwar's, just to kind of unpack it. But after listening to Scumdogs, I think the greater Gwar universe is pretty entertaining. It's clearly it's definitely a love hate band for just about anybody. Mm-hmm. But you know, I think it's a band that you have to take with a bit of a sense of humor at times. And if you can't look at that, you're not going to make it too far into the record. And you know, even then, there's probably some things that are too offensive for my taste. But I think that just humor and entertainment, it works on a lot of levels for me, if you can take it lightly.
Okay, Jay, what's something that you liked about the record?
Well, I think it's a pretty interesting mashup of heavy sounds. You know, actually, some of this sounds like Anthrax, which is a band we just recently reviewed.
Mm-hmm.
Both the John Bush era and the sort of earlier thrashier era. But then you hear like some Sabbath in here. You hear some Metallica. I heard some L7. It gets a little bit alternative at times, which I was kind of surprised on. I was expecting it to be, pretty much pure metal all the time. Vocally, they change it up enough to keep it pretty engaging, between either having different singers or different styles of singing or spoken stuff or whatever. I think the part I liked the most, though, was the lead guitar stuff on here is actually pretty creative. And I think it helps a lot of these songs kind of reach a space that's a little bit more distinctive, musically, really melodic. There's a couple parts on here, a couple guitar leads that even have like a alternative 80s feel to them. So like Sick of You, for example, I really like the guitar work on that song. I think it really elevates it to to actually being a pretty, pretty fun, like heavier rock song. So, you know, there's some moments on here where I think there's, you know, a ton of creativity, and I think it's a kind of a fun mix up of everything from heavier punk to thrash to, you know, hard rock to metal. So, from that aspect, I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Just to follow up on that, I think when I was listening to this, I was expecting just sort of a goofy take on metal, but there was definitely a little bit more going on than I was expecting. Mm-hmm. There's some of that like mid to late 80s, like crossover between hardcore and punk, or hardcore and metal, that you started to hear with like a band like you mentioned with Anthrax, but like Suicidal Tendencies or some other stuff that like sort of track 8, Vlad the Impaler is a good example of that, where it's not quite metal. There is some like double kick stuff, but it also kind of touches on a little bit of like 80s hardcore sound almost, which is weird. I wasn't expecting that. And then, like you said, there's like almost in some ways like an alt metal, which, again, kind of weird. I was not like expecting. I was expecting like a straightforward kind of like in the way that like the Misfits kind of stick to like one kind of sound or formula in terms of doing their, presentation. Yeah. Which I did hear some Misfits in like the gang vocal stuff that was going on in some of the songs. I was an obvious, like, you know, nod to them. But then there was other times where I was like listening to it. And I'm like, this isn't far off from like a Quiet Riot song.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it touched on a lot of different things.
They approached some anthems. There's no doubt about that.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It goes without saying though, that, you know, like what OC mentioned, this is a band that's like heavily driven by their live show. So I was trying to like listen to this, not just in terms of what do the songs sound like, but like I really tried to hone in on like the lyrics and like, well, what would be going on, you know, live. So like a song like Slaughterama, I don't know, whatever, how you say that.
Yeah.
Like that to me, like on record, sounds kind of goofy and not all that, like it sounds like a bad Beastie Boys song.
Mm-hmm.
But when I put it in the like mindset of like, well, what would this be like live? Like this might actually be pretty entertaining live. So it got me thinking about like comparisons to other soundtracks for like, you know, like the Rocky Horror Picture Show, for example. You know, there's there's songs for that I don't know that they necessarily work as well away from the visual presentation. Some of them do, but not all of them. And it just got me thinking about like a band that relies so heavily on a visual presentation. Can they pull it off on a 13 song record? And I'm curious about, you know, not knowing enough about the band, how much of the visual is decided before the song is written and how much of the song informs what they're doing visually. So I'll ask you this, OC, when they're performing live, is it basically a show in the sense that like there are speaking parts in between songs and like there's a story, or is it that they're playing a bunch of songs and they have like some stuff going on during the songs?
I would say it's there is a narrative to the live show, though there's not a whole lot of it wouldn't be, you know, a lot of scenes without music. Like one of the notes that I took down was that the song Slaughterama, that is kind of the prototypical type of Gwar song that kind of reaches out to me. And I think like, okay, I see exactly what they would be doing on stage.
Right.
Slaughterama, the song is kind of like you know, it was a game show and they reference killing hippies and Nazis and such. And
right.
So during the, you know, it's a loose narrative. It's not going to be anything tied too tightly to the story, but you'd see them probably bring out some type of character. And I think every time I've seen them, I've seen a character get decapitated in the show, and then they'll do that for a song, and then maybe they'll just, that character will spray blood on the audience for, you know, another 2-3 songs while they go to some songs that don't necessarily fit the narrative.
Okay, gotcha. So it's like Gallagher way.
that's kind of a decent analogy there. When I saw them in 2008. It was in the middle of a presidential race, and they pitted the characters against each other in an intergalactic space wrestling ring. Both were decapitated and sprayed blood on the audience. And, you know, that's just kind of what Gwar does. And there is a story, even if it's like, even if it's broken up in like into small little episodic portions that might not necessarily feed off of each other.
Gotcha. Jay, I don't know about you, but, you know, in listening to this, I'm reminded of, there's a number of bands that like teeter on the edge of between like parody and, you know, like Steel Panther is like a parody of 80s metal.
Yeah.
But then you have a band like, we've mentioned them before, like the Upper Crust. They're not really parodying. They're doing like a whole shtick. Like they have a whole thing that they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, they're different characters. That
right.
They're not making fun. They're paying homage, but they're doing it in a way that's fun and, you know, in character.
Right. And I think I was expecting this to be like a bunch of bad like metal used as a vehicle to tell these stories and these have these songs, but there's actually like quite a bit of musicianship that's going on on these songs. So it makes it far less of a sort of a bad parody as much as like I would have been curious to, or I'd still be curious to read some interviews about like why they decided to go this direction, because clearly there's enough talent where like you could have just written just like sort of, I guess you'd say, straight, you know, rock or metal songs. But there was clearly an interest in like horror and, you know, gore. I wonder if these guys were like, you know, really into you know, Night of the Living Dead and that kind of stuff. And that sort of like, you know.
That's interesting. Yeah. Now, I'm not really sure what their what the beginning story of all that is, but it's really interesting to see where they switched from basic punk roots to the whole theatrical performance.
Well, it's obviously similar to Kiss in that way, right? In terms of they're probably closer to that in terms of like, yeah, I mean, the music, the image is part of the music, at least when it was started. Like, you can't disconnect the two, and there's characters there, and
sure,
I think this band took it a slightly different direction, obviously. But I have to admit, you know, I've always struggled with what I would consider, I use the term like joke rock when I was younger, and bands that were like trying to be too funny, I didn't know how to take it. I didn't enjoy it very much. I'm finding as I get older, like, I'm just able to understand it, or at least just be more open to different things.
Lighten up.
So
Junior.
I was always, huh?
So lighten up, Junior.
Well, kinda. So I, you know, I get this more now. One thing I thought about was, especially with Slaughterama, since we're talking about that song, do you guys remember the band Green Jelly?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
So that was kind of musically the same kind of thing. Weren't they the same kind of image as Gwar? I just remember that music video being played to death.
The Three Little Pigs. That's a good question. I mean, I remember that getting played to death too.
I can't remember the video.
It was like a claymation style video.
Yeah, it was like
musically
animated.
I think it sounded a lot like this.
I remember the song. Yeah, it does kind of. It does sound in the same vein.
Yeah, I don't know where they were coming from either.
They were considered comedy rock.
Not as successful, I would say.
Well, I'm not sure what. I'm not sure what Green Jello are doing nowadays, but Gwar's still playing.
Yeah. Yes, this is the show where people bet their lives to win something big. Cause when your life is shit, then you haven't got much to lose on Slaughterama.
One interesting thing when I was researching just a little bit of the record is that they actually had their own Destinations Festival in Virginia throughout like the, I don't know when it started, but it's the Gwarbecue. So I don't think they do it every year, but something meaningful is that one of the last couple of Gwarbecues that they had, they actually gave a Viking funeral to the character of Odorous, which seems fitting for them.
Yeah. Yeah, I think they have a bar. I think there's an actual Gwar bar.
A Gwar bar?
I think so. I want to double check that, but I'm pretty sure.
I mean, that kind of gets, you know, I just find the, I find the Gwar universe really interesting and kind of entertaining. And, you know, I'm sure that this is just a snippet of it. But from what I can tell, this is what a lot of fans say. This is the shining diamond in the discography.
Yep, Gwar Bar opened in 2015 in Richmond, Virginia.
All right.
So you got to make a pilgrimage.
A pilgrimage to Virginia. All right. Maybe I'll wait till the next. I'll wait till the next Gwar-BQ.
There you go.
I heard a lot of New York influence on this band. Did you guys hear that? Like,
there was definitely something, and I couldn't pin it down. But now that you say that, in terms of like their New York hardcore metal sound.
Yeah. I kept thinking of New York bands when I heard them.
Sometimes when I heard the punk roots, especially like I think you referenced Vlad The Impaler earlier. Mm-hmm. I started thinking about some like Naked Ray Gun, some of that. But when I thought of Naked Ray Gun when I heard some of the punk roots.
Interesting. That would not have been a band that I had would have brought up.
Not all the time, but
but for that, yeah, I hear what you're saying.
What's up with Sick of You? There's a middle section where he sings in this totally different voice. Is that the same singer or is it a different person? It kind of sounds like a little bit like an alternative version of Bon Scott. You know what I'm talking about? In the middle of that song. Like he says something like, bring it down. And they're like, bring it down. And he goes into this like completely different voice. Is that a different person or is that the main singer?
That is the lead guitarist, Mike Dirks, Ballsack, The Jaws of Death.
Okay.
He's credited with lead guitar, rhythm guitar, and backing vocals. And
I really liked his voice. I was like, hey, I could hear a whole record of this guy singing.
We need a Ballsack solo record.
Yeah. I kind of dig this.
Well, there's a lot of different singers on the record.
Yeah.
So for them to not let him shine a little bit more there, I don't know what the message was, but
I don't know.
And I think this coming out in 1990 is also interesting. Like 1990 is the year we've reviewed the least.
Mm-hmm.
This sounds a little ahead of its time. I don't know. It doesn't sound like 1990 to me. Like it sounds more like maybe middle 90s.
Sounds more aware of itself than what you would expect in 1990.
And production wise it's like I would expect it to be a little bit tinnier sounding and like more reverby. I mean, not that there's not reverb on here, but we've reviewed some records from 90 where it's like huge echo sounds and like thinner tones and, you know, what late 80s production sounded like. This sounds pretty beefy and just musically is, I don't know, pretty unique for 1990. I mean, yeah, we talked about some of the references, but the way they bring some of these things together is, it seems a little ahead of its time, if I might say so. I never thought I would be this impressed musically with Gwar, but I guess I was just going in with such low expectations that.
There you go.
I remember thinking about after I said, let's review Gwar. And then like, what did I get myself into? I mean, I have to say, like, my expectations were all over the place because, you know, I had seen them live and it is a very entertaining experience. But really, I had never had any interest in going back to listen to it and see if it stands on its own. And there's definitely a good handful that are deserving of rotation, you know?
Well, we haven't gotten to the what we didn't like part yet.
Right. I intentionally didn't want to say anything like that.
So let's talk about that, Jay.
Yeah.
What was it about this record that maybe you didn't like?
Well, I mean, vocally, it's limited. you know, the main style of the vocal was a little tough to listen to a full record of. The style, I think the second half of this record gets, you know, kind of into a boilerplate kind of format where there's not a whole lot of surprises left until the last song, Cold Place to Park. I think from Horror of Yig through Sexecutioner, it's pretty predictable at that point. So you just kind of like, once you kind of get the band through the first half of the record, the second half is just, it seems like more of the same. I think that's my biggest thing I didn't like. It's just, this is it's a fun little creative thing. And it's fun to have, you know, stories and different characters and this all a whole other world. I don't know that I need, you know, nearly an hour of it. 4 to 5 songs of it is great and fun. And then after that, it's like, okay, well, I've kind of heard this already. So just in general, I think the band is a little bit limited. And so it just gets a little bit boring. And didn't say quite as engaged to the rest of the record as I did the first half.
What about USC? What was there in going through this stuff that maybe didn't work as well for you?
You know, I mostly piggyback off of what you guys just said, that the second half gets a little bit repetitive. You know, you get what it gets more into, more of what you just expect to hear from it. You know, I think there's times where I think I heard a little bit more chorus on the guitars than I really, really liked. But I kind of feel that just coming from the 80s, maybe you're feeling some of that that hair metal guitar just kind of carry over. But, you know, there's a lot of times where the guitars just do hit you in the chest. So I guess that I don't know, maybe I'm being a little nitpicky on that. But I'm not sure I also needed 13 songs of it.
Yeah.
When I heard that there was an 11-song release, and I think you mentioned, I forgot what two songs you mentioned. Was it Cool Place to Park and
Years Without Light?
And yeah, those were both that I probably would have skipped. And if I had 11 songs, I probably would have been a little bit happier. But yeah, just a little bit. You know, I think you've said of several 90s albums, maybe we didn't need to pack the CD with it.
I'm genuinely surprised there are no skits. I would have thought that this would be a band that
would have
a couple of skits between songs.
Yeah. Well, Sexecutioner and Slaughterama kind of get there.
Right.
Pretty close, right?
I wonder if they have more skits in future ones, though.
Yeah, that's true.
I hope not.
Why, you going to start going through the...
Well, I just, those are probably my least favorite. I mean, Slaughterama was fun to listen to one time, but I can't imagine like my second and third time through, I was getting annoyed with it. Sexecutioner, I found like difficult to listen to because at some point it's just like thrash metal with a guy yelling, like talking over it loudly. You're just like, so there's a lot to take in. I don't know what to focus on.
Didn't necessarily need 4 minutes of it.
Right.
I believe that they start getting into skits on the 1994 record, This Toilet Earth, which has a number of songs that are in like the, you know, 56 second to 1 minute and 28 second range that definitely look like they would be skit length. I don't know that for sure, but that's what just looking at the it's also 16 tracks.
Oh boy.
The thing that I found that didn't work for me, and you brought it up, Jay, is I just found the vocal sometimes got lost for me, where he's sticking to that like metal thrash format, and I actually couldn't make out the lyrics as clear. Like on the first couple tracks, I very, very clearly can make out what the lyrics are. And then as they started to go into the record, because they were kind of getting the more formulaic sort of sounds, like you guys mentioned, I also found like the vocals became sort of less important. And quite frankly, some of the humor is like a little dated for me in terms of like,
oh, sure.
There's some stuff that I know they're being outrageous. And I know they're intentionally trying to shock people and stuff like that. But it didn't work. So
some of that really didn't age well.
No. And I don't think we need to talk about why this didn't do more commercially or maybe on radio or.
Well, that's why I brought up Green Jelly, though, is because that video was like big that year. Like,
yeah,
it got
but
played
it wasn't.
Shit out of it.
This has got some language issues.
True. And, well, there's some songs on here that not all of them do they?
Most of them, and if they don't, they have some other issues with regards to their humor and subject matter. Does Sexecutioner have a bunch of bad words? I don't remember, but I know that there's some other issues. So yeah, this is definitely a cult band that is they're not getting out of that. There's no way. So let's talk overall rating. Worthy album, better EP, or decent single? OC, I'm starting with you.
So this one's hard for me. But all in all, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Generally, the scale of what was 7 songs? What was that?
7 to 8 is like your 70s album. You know,
that's kind of where I'm at. There's a few that like you mentioned earlier, I have to cringe at despite going in with a, you know, light sense of humor and trying to be entertained. I still, there's several songs and parts of songs that are just very cringeworthy. So, but I'm at like 7 songs. So I guess that's one of those, like just barely, solid album. You know, there's points where I could skip over, but, you know, I think it works best as a whole. You know, I'd rather hear a few back to back, and see it play in the, like I said before, the greater Gwar universe, as opposed to, you know, just one here, one there. I'm going to go a solid album.
Okay. Jay.
I'm at an EP. I've got the Salaminizer.
I read it as Salaminizer.
Salaminizer. Sick of You, King Queen. I liked Cool Place to Park. It's different. I like that. So I'm about 4 or 5 songs. And I think this is a band that, like, if I was friends with them or managing them, I would encourage them to do EPs. I don't know that, like, and make them like super different too. That would be kind of fun. Like, cause you can hear they can do some different things on the record. It's just to do a whole record. I felt like it got to this place like we mentioned in the second half, where it's just like, they're just making songs, you know, there's sort of a little bit out of ideas. It's like, well, we got to fill this record out and put a bunch of Gwar songs on it. So let's just write a bunch more songs. Whereas I think it would be fun if a band like this would be more focused on like doing these little EPs every year that are like very different, thematic, and like more like stories, you know. I think that would be much more fun. So I'm at an EP.
I'm with you. I teeter on. I'm at about 5 songs. and most of the same ones that you mentioned. It doesn't quite get to an album status for me. I think it works well. I mean, if they had split this into two EPs, maybe it would work better. But I needed some, I just needed some more variety. I feel like they could do it and pull it off in their style if they had taken some more chances in terms of the sounds, because they almost go there in a few times, in a few occasions where they play with some other sounds, like, you know, like I mentioned, you know, track four, Slaughterama, has a very like Beastie Boys kind of feel, License to Ill feel to it, and I feel like they, that's a good use of them playing around with that sound, and they could have done that with some other different takes on things. Like, what would it sound like if they tried to do an 80s U2 song? I don't know. Maybe it would have sounded stupid. Right. But what the hell? Give it a shot. So, sure. Yeah, I'm at more of an EP, but I'm glad I listened to this finally, because this is a band that I was like, I will probably never listen to that band. And now I'm like, I actually kind of like a couple songs. I can see where people dig this. I don't know if I would want to go to a show, because I really don't want to have to get red blood, whether, you know, fake or not. I don't want to get that sprayed on me. So not a fan of interactive audience participation at things like that. So Jay, maybe Zora will get into this. She likes the metal.
Oh. I wouldn't be surprised going forward if highly theatrical interactive music is what's popular live, because
how does this not have a show on Netflix? Why isn't there a Gwar show?
Well,
think about what is the Metalocalypse from Adult Swim? Yeah, it's kind of the same of taking metal to the nth degree to some extent, right?
I've actually never seen that.
Have you guys ever seen that?
No.
Oh, okay. No. Yeah. It's I mean, there's no monsters from space. But it's the premise is still, you know, taking, you know, normal metal that is turned up to 11 to just, you know, double down and crank it even higher. So it's kind of it's worth checking out. I don't want to give too much away, but it's worth checking out.
All right.
Were either of you guys thrown by, like, I was aware of the supposed backstory where they're supposed to be from space. I was like, why don't they sing more songs about their planet? Why are all their songs about, like, middle class East Coast culture?
They sang what's the song? It's
Death Pod.
I forgot where it was on the album. Isn't that one about how Gwar came to Earth, more or less?
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
I think it is.
See, that's an issue there, because it should be sequenced better.
Right, that needs to be track one.
That should be track one. Like, here, we're explaining our story. We've come to Earth. We're the Scumdogs of the Universe. You know, like,
yeah.
Give me the narrative in order.
I think that's a fair criticism.
And then they can get into their observations of American culture.
Right.
Sure.
Through the eyes of
if they're explaining themselves coming to Earth this late on the second record, what's the first one about?
Right. Planning to come to Earth. It's just all about the planning. Like, we're building a ship. We're getting the coordinates to Earth.
But half seriously, I'm like, if you're gonna have a concept, like, commit to it.
You know? Jay's very invested in the story. He needs more, it fleshed out.
I'd argue they're pretty committed.
I don't know. Some of this material is making me ask questions.
Well, they're willing to dress like that for 25 years.
That's true. But they have their own bar now, so that's pretty cool. Correct. OC, thank you for joining us on this episode. This was a lot of fun. I'm glad we got to do this for our second Halloween episode ever.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me. This was a lot of fun for me, too.
Awesome. If you are a listener, know that by being a Patreon, you could have done this, and maybe you can do it next year by joining us at patreon.com/digmeout. For just $1 a month, you can join us to get bonus content. You can be entered into contests to win stuff like this. And like our fourth quarter contest that's coming up soon. And also get to vote in polls, our monthly polls for albums we review that are suggested through our website. And of course, if you like what you heard, please consider leaving us some positive feedback over at iTunes. So on this very scary episode... for Jay, for Jagged Knife Jay and Terrible Tim, we're out. And we'll be back next week with a ghoulish episode of Dig Me Out.
Thanks for listening. To support the podcast, visit www.patreon.com/digmeout and become a monthly subscriber at www.digmeoutpodcast.com, where you can find links to our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram pages, as well as our merchandise store at Zazzle.com.
Ha 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 ha.